America, bountiful, innovative, entrepreneurial, diverse, progressive, sick? Americans get sick more often than Europeans and people in other industrialized countries, and they're getting sicker. Since the mid-90s, the number of Americans suffering from at least three chronic illnesses nearly doubled, and America's international ranking for infant mortality and lifespan also plunged. There are many reasons why this is taking place. One may be right in front of you.
Over the past 20 years, there's been an almost logarithmic increase in a whole series of chronic illnesses.
The things we're seeing today aren't normal. We didn't see them 30 years ago or 50 years ago.
Illnesses that weren't epidemic before are now epidemic, and at a scale that is just monumental.
People are getting sicker. What's changed? Well, one thing that's changed is the food. And the most radical change is the genetic engineering of our food supply.
We have gone from food in its whole food form to food undergoing a scientific experiment.
We have hundreds of millions of acres of genetically modified crops that have been planted in the United States, and yet most people are not aware.
The normal consumer, unfortunately, especially these days, is just busy trying to hold on to their house or, you know, put their kids through school, and they're not aware of anything being genetically modified.
Obama's USDA is owned by the biotech just as much as every previous administration. And if we don't do anything, like within a decade, every single major crop with any significant market size is going to be genetically modified, and we're not going to know it.
GMO, genetically modified organisms. They take genes from one species and force it into the DNA of other species. And they can mix and match between species that have never normally made it. So they have spider genes that they put into goats in the hopes that they can milk the goat to get spiderweb protein to make bulletproof vests. I'm not making this up. They've taken cow genes and put them into pigs so that the pigs have cow hides. They've taken human genes and put it into corn to make spermicide. And for the food we eat, there's two main categories. The herbicide-tolerant crops, they can spray them with herbicide and not kill them, or the pesticide-producing crops that produce their own toxic insecticide that if a bug bites those plants, it breaks open the stomach and kills them. So they're completely swapping genes between the normal species barriers, creating new organisms that were not part of the evolutionary process.
The general public has the impression that genetic engineering is somehow a precise science. More accurately, it's submicroscopic shooting from the hip.
The very process of genetic engineering creates unpredicted side effects. You take a gene and make millions of copies, and then put them in a gun, literally, and then shoot that gun into a plate of millions of cells. And then you clone those cells into a plant.
Typically what they will put onto that is a virus or a part of a virus in order to turn that gene on.
Now the process of insertion plus cloning creates massive collateral damage. There can be hundreds or thousands of mutations up and down the DNA, and hundreds or thousands of genes can change their levels of expression in the naturally functioning plant. This creates unpredicted side effects.
From a biophysics perspective, when we look at the signature now of that entire gene sequence, it's foreign. It does not exist anywhere in nature. And therefore, our immune system, which is truly a grand electromagnetic sensor system, looks at that material, that gene sequence that is supposed to be food, whether it's soy or corn or whatever it might be, looks at that and says, I've never seen that sequence ever. It doesn't exist in nature. It's foreign. It attacks. It creates an inflammatory reaction and attacks that sequence.
Many of the diseases that we deal with, in fact, most of the diseases that we deal with have as a source inflammation. many of them, the source is inflammation in the gut, which is, of course, the first interface between the body and any kind of food, including GMO food.
In 1996, genetically engineered soy and corn were introduced into the American diet. Since then, numerous digestive disorders related to gut inflammation have been on the rise in the U.S. population. Is this just a coincidence? But inflammation creates additional serious disorders unrelated to digestion.
So I think we should probably look at allergies. I'm sure we should look at autoimmune diseases. And, you know, basically anything that's related to inflammation, heart disease, kidney disease, diabetes, I mean, it doesn't stop, thyroid disease.
Protecting the food supply, making it safe, making it nutritious is one of the most fundamental duties of government and then, of course, of FDA. When you think about the importance of food to public health, to the health of people, there's really nothing more fundamental.
The current FDA policy on GMOs, created in 1992, says that the agency is not aware of any information showing that GMOs are significantly different. Therefore, no safety studies are necessary. It turns out that in 1998, a lawsuit forced 44,000 secret internal memos into the public domain, and they showed a different story.
As I combed through those 44,000 pages of memoranda and other documents, I was shocked because it became clear that the FDA had been lying repeatedly since 1992 because they claimed that there was an overwhelming consensus within the scientific community that these foods are safe. But the overwhelming consensus within their own scientific staff was exactly opposite. These foods could not be presumed safe.
The overwhelming consensus among the scientists working at the FDA were not only that GMOs were different, but that they were dangerous. They could lead to allergies, toxins, new diseases, and nutritional problems, they said over and over in their memos. They urged their superiors to require long-term studies, but were ignored. Why? The person in charge of policy at the FDA was Michael Taylor, Monsanto's former attorney, later Monsanto's vice president, now back at the FDA as U.S. food safety czar.
What Monsanto and the biotech industry wanted from the FDA was a policy that created the illusion that genetically engineered foods are being diligently regulated, but that in fact imposed no burdens at all, that in fact had zero regulation. And the FDA has pulled that off masterfully.
And so the FDA does not approve any genetically modified crops. There's a voluntary consultation process where companies like Monsanto can produce whatever science it wants. If the FDA asks for further information, they're typically ignored. At the end of this meaningless exercise, the FDA produces a letter which reminds Monsanto that it's its responsibility to determine if the foods are safe. So the same company, Monsanto, that told us that PCBs, Agent Orange, and DDT were safe and lied, can tell us if GMOs are safe. In fact, they don't even have to tell us. They can put it on the market without telling the FDA or to consumers.
If they have been creating the kinds of problems that the FDA scientists warned that they could be, that the various scientists in our lawsuit warned about, that the expert panel of the Royal Society of Canada has warned about, that the British Medical Association has warned about, that scores and scores of other scientific experts have warned about, then there already could have been major damage created to the health of every American and to the health of coming generations.
The FDA, the USDA, and the EPA are all responsible for different aspects of our food production, and they're signing off on this in a way that is, it's beyond outrageous.
They've appointed known advocates of GMO food to positions like Secretary of Agriculture, Food Czar, important positions in which independent decision-making should be done. And appointing people that work for the main offender on this to those positions is insane.
I think this is the most alarming thing that I have seen in Washington, that we would clear new, unique products for human consumption without careful, independent testing of these products. I can only think that money is the reason.
The American Academy of Environmental Medicine took a very strong position against GMO because such research as has been done is very, very disturbing.
The American Academy cited animal studies showing infertility, immune problems, accelerated aging, complications with cholesterol and insulin, and changes in the liver, kidney, spleen, and gastrointestinal system.
And unfortunately, the American consumer for 20 years now has been consuming the foods that the FDA scientists said should not be on the market until they're proven safe, because the FDA continues to lie about the truth.
When you have the power to manipulate the entire structure of evolution, it would be irresponsible for any scientist, no matter how wise, whether a Nobel laureate or otherwise, to take that power and to use it without a full appreciation of its consequences.
The biotech companies do their own research. I call it tobacco science. They use the wrong control group, the wrong detection method, the wrong statistics, and their feeding trials are so short, they could never identify things like cancer or reproductive disorders or birth defects. They've got bad science down to a science.
No one has the right to play dice, to play roulette with the entire genetic integrity of life on the planet.
There's a soil bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis, or BT. And if you take that bacteria and gather it up and use it as a spray, the BT toxin produced by the bacteria will kill insects. So engineers take the gene that produces the toxin and insert it into corn and cotton and allow the plants to do the killing.
Every single cell within that plant is producing a toxic protein.
BT is designed to break open the stomach of insects and kill them. So when the doctors hear about this, that BT corn was introduced into our diet in the mid-90s, they say this may explain the increase in gastrointestinal problems that they're seeing in their practice. But the EPA says, don't worry about BT toxin. It's completely harmless to human beings and animals because it only affects insects. However, a study that came out in February 2012 showed that the EPA got it wrong. It does break open little pores in human cells, and it might cause the same kind of disruption in our guts as it's causing in the insects that it kills.
If Bacillus thuringiensis is causing an increased propensity for our intestine to become permeable or leaky, and for foods to be presented to our bloodstream in a premature fashion, the havoc that it will cause will be across the entire spectrum of disease, from premature aging and Alzheimer's to Parkinson's to autism to cancer to asthma. There is no part of the spectrum, because we start the same as if you buy a brand new car and it says on that it's meant to run on gas and you go put diesel in it, you can expect it won't go very far. So when you put the wrong fuel into your body, and by making your intestine leaky, we are permitting building blocks to go into our body that are the wrong fuel. They have not been adequately prepared by our digestive processes and by the simple fact that the healthy flora in our body converts our food to active things, like the right form of vitamin K is only elaborated in your body. Many of the foods that we eat are not in their active form until the healthy flora begins to work on them. And disrupting that flora is why we see so much of the eczema, so much of the asthma, so much of the allergies in our population.
There's only been one human feeding study on genetically modified foods. And they found that part of the gene inserted into soybeans that make the soybeans Roundup Ready transferred into the DNA of bacteria living inside our intestines and stayed there. Furthermore, that bacteria was not killable with Roundup, suggesting that the gene remained active. This means long after we stop eating genetically modified foods, we may still have these genetically modified proteins produced continuously inside of us. They never checked to see if the BT toxin gene transferred from, say, corn chips into our gut bacteria and continued to function. If it does, it might turn our intestinal flora into living pesticide factories. This might explain why 93% of pregnant women tested in Canada had the BT toxin in their blood, as well as in the blood of 80% of their unborn fetuses. The authors of the study suggested that the BT toxin came as a result of eating the milk and meat of animals that ate Monsanto's BT corn. But I think a more plausible explanation is that the BT toxin was produced continuously inside their own digestive tract.
What's happening in the research article that I'm reading is that a lot of the conditions that seem to be on the rise are connected to intestinal permeability. To me, I think that this is actually one of the important parts of why GMOs might be harmful.
One of the things that really I see a lot in children now is that kids come in with leaky guts. They're usually in an intestine, there should be tight junctions in the intestine. But these kids are coming in, their guts are not creating these tight junctions. The food they're eating is leaking into their bloodstream. They're creating an antibody response to those foods, and so they're coming in with food intolerances and food allergies.
Once intestinal permeability rises, then it's possible for larger bits of food to go through, bits that really should have been digested fully before getting assimilated. Once these go into the bloodstream, the body develops a reaction to them, and this reaction is an allergic reaction.
I have a son who has severe food allergies. And he got the food allergies back in 09, August 25th, 2009 to be exact. And I have literally, from that day forward, have been on a mission trying to figure out how did my son get these food allergies. I found out that our food supply is genetically modified. And guess what? The food that my son ate on August 25th, 2009 was raw corn. The corn that almost killed him. All I could hear him go is and the itching. I'm like, what the heck is going on? And he has turned red. He couldn't breathe properly. I was in panic. I called 911. I was just like, I think my son's having a food allergy attack.
It's okay.
And I immediately took him to the doctors, and I got all these tests done, and sure enough, he's deadly allergic to corn now.
25, 30, 35 years ago, no one was allergic to anything. And now you have allergies. I have people with black pepper that couldn't have black pepper today. There's, you know, celiacs that have wheat, gluten allergies, people that have allergies to, of course, you know, the basics like dairy and seafood, but everything. I have people that are allergic to parsley and just regular natural chlorophyll plants.
But we're talking about food. Food's become harmful. How did that happen? So when you link it to the GMO issue, it resonates like you would not believe.
Patients with allergies, I try to keep them away from GMO foods because they'll react to them, and they'll tell you that.
It's my fourth child who has food allergies. We have no family history of this. I knew that I had taken care of myself through every pregnancy the exact same way. And as friends kept saying, what did you do differently? What did you do differently? I had no answer. And suddenly, in learning of this relationship between GMOs and food allergies, I finally had my answer. And in learning about genetically modified foods, I was also able to do something about it. And literally, within a 24-hour period, we cleaned out the entire kitchen. There were the items that we had been feeding our children for the last 6 years, we just literally threw into the trash. And so at first, where I was excited and I was relieved at having discovered all of this, I then went through a really hard stage where I just cried because I thought, what have I done to my children and what has been done to them without my consent?
And I have kids who are allergic to every food group. How is that possible? And not just a few of them, quite a few of them. Almost impossible to manage. Moms are coming and saying, what do I feed my kid?
I have seen firsthand exponential growth in allergies. And yet, when I improve the quality of my patients' diets, meaning prescribing a non-GMO diet, prescribing organic food, their symptoms go away.
In most of my patients, because they have some sort of immune or inflammatory response to the GMO foods, I have to take them off of the non-GMO foods that are related. So I have to take them off of all corn. I have to take them off of all grains because my experience is that once the immune system has been inspired to have a response, that they react, you know, to GMO and non-GMO.
So I had a healthy patient come in, 30-year-old woman, who told me now when she eats any food, her skin literally overheats. Literally anything that she's eating is causing a problem in her skin. And she says to me, what could this be? Well, what we do is we take her off of all of the food that she's eating, and she starts back adding in highest quality organic foods in their base forms, right? As she's doing that, she suddenly is getting better. You know, we might have to use enzymes or other things to help her, but as she starts to get better, guess what? When we add back in corn or soy, she can consume it if it's not genetically modified.
I'm concerned about all the health issues that I'm seeing, but the one that I am most alarmed about is autistic spectrum, which is literally skyrocketed.
We can't say for sure that GMOs have anything to do with autism, but we can't say for sure that it doesn't. In fact, there's been an increase in autism since GMOs were introduced, and animals that eat GMOs, both in laboratory and in livestock situations, have shown some telltale signs that some practitioners say are linked with autism.
Studies with pigs showed the allergy response from the GMO food reproduced all of the physiological changes that we see in the intestine, the inflammatory response in the stomach to those foreign proteins that we see with autistic children. When I reported this in a symposium in Germany, I had a doctor that has spent his entire career working with autistic children. He came up and asked me a few questions. When I reported exactly what we were seeing symptom-wise, behavioral-wise, with the rats and with the pigs and with the cattle that are being fed GMO versus non-GMO, he said that's exactly what we're finding in our autistic children. And why, when I could modify the diet of an autistic child 10 years ago and have a very excellent response and remediation and recovery, why I'm not getting that response now, because we're no longer able to change that microflora back because we're continuing to feed our GMO contaminated food to our children.
Our son is 9 and a half, and he has he was diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder about 6 years ago. And we've used many interventions in his therapy, but about 2 years ago we learned about GMO foods and the potential harm of this kind of food in ourselves and in our son. And particularly in the last 2 years, we've seen some nice improvements in combination with other things, but keep cleaning up his diet with non-GMO foods has been a big success for us.
I just always felt there had to be a connection to autism and all the gut-related problems that our kids have. My son in particular always had GI problems, fungal infections and parasites, bacteria, viruses in his GI tract that we had been treating over the years. But until we took GMO completely out of his diet, did I see the biggest change in him behaviorally, especially.
My son is 10 years old now. He's autistic. And about 5 years ago, we learned at an autism conference about GMOs, and we just decided immediately that that was one of the things we were going to have to change about his diet. And when we did, the change was quite profound. He had a lot of gut issues, as do most children with autism, and we noticed immediately a relief in the symptoms. The bloating and the horrible bowel movements seemed to subside substantially, and now his gut is like a neurotypical kid. It's really amazing. And we haven't done much to his gut other than get him on an organic diet and get him away from the GMOs.
The vast majority of genetically modified crops are engineered to make it easier for farmers to kill weeds. For example, Monsanto's Roundup Ready crops, which comprise most of today's GMOs, can survive applications of Monsanto's best-selling weed killer, Roundup.
The active ingredient of Roundup is called glyphosate, and it was patented as an herbicide by Monsanto in 1974. but 10 years earlier, it was patented as a broad-spectrum chelator. Now, chelation is the molecular level of hugging and not letting go. The way that it kills weeds is it makes the nutrients unavailable to the plant, so it weakens the defenses of the plant. Then it promotes the diseases in the soil, which end up killing the plant. Now, this means that plants treated with Roundup have a reduction in available nutrients. They're weak and they're sick. The animals that eat the nutrient-deficient plants, they become nutrient-deficient and weak and sick. Then we eat the animals and the plants that are nutrient-deficient, and we may become weak and sick. In addition, the residues of the Roundup in the plant can end up in our bodies where they can chelate, hug some of the nutrients that are in our bodies, making them less available as well.
In areas, very often right to the row specifically where the glyphosate was applied, those plants are getting sicker earlier. Tissue tests are documenting deficiencies in manganese, copper, and zinc. As a result, the food is less nutritious. It's showing up in the animals, and glyphosate use is doing it, and it's following and working its way right up the food chain.
Those deficiencies are very well documented as being factors in animal diseases as well as in human diseases. You really need a balance of all the nutrition, all the nutrients, to keep this physical body really functioning in all the areas, because all of them are mutually supportive and interdependent.
Basically, if you had one trace mineral and you were looking at a specific disease, you would see an animal survive and respond to treatment, this type of thing. If you got two trace minerals that were deficient, you had a more virulent, in other words, a more aggressive disease pattern, even with the same identical disease. And when you got to the three elements that were severely deficient, then things really got serious. To the point that they probably wouldn't respond to treatment, and we'd have a very, very high death loss.
What do livestock in the United States eat? Roundup ready crops. Roundup ready soy, corn, cottonseed, canola meal, sugar beet pulp, and now alfalfa. The bulk of their diet is Roundup ready crops. And those crops are nutrient deficient and have high concentrations of Roundup.
The glyphosate problem has a number of issues for us. And one of the very sad side effects of glyphosate are birth defects. In the towns where people were workers on the farm, particularly the soybean farms, we had as much as 70 times increase in the number of birth defects in these sprayed areas. And in fact, research of looking at studies around the world show that glyphosate is in fact genotoxic, which means it does directly cause birth defects. And that doesn't necessarily mean exposure directly to the body. In other words, the person was underneath the sprayer and got sprayed. So exposure can also be ingestion, because that is an exposure of the body to glyphosate.
Lab animals fed Roundup ready soy have had serious reproductive disorders. In mice, the testicles changed, including damage to the young sperm cells. In rats, there were changes in the uterus and ovaries. The DNA functioned differently in the embryo offspring of mice. When female rats were fed genetically modified soy, more than half of their babies died within 3 weeks. The babies were also smaller and could not reproduce. When mice were fed genetically modified Roundup Ready and BT corn, they had fewer babies and smaller babies. Preliminary evidence that's not yet published can be even worse. In rats, the testicles changed from pink to blue. In hamsters, by the third generation, most lost the ability to have babies. Some had hair growing in their mouths. This is astounding research, and yet it's never followed up. Typically, the industry distorts or denies the findings, pretending that there's no problem.
Where we used to have one fertility clinic for people, We now have an average of 14.
In our community, where I live, within 100 miles of my house, there's 50 infertility clinics. 20 years ago, there probably wasn't any. One of the ladies in our local community that works in a hairdressing shop where the ladies get to talking and this type of thing anyway, they just accept the fact that to bring forth one healthy baby, and they may have one, two, three, four miscarriages before they finally have one that takes. So what does that all mean long term? I don't know. It's scary. We just know that fertility is declining. There may be other reasons. I don't know the answer to that. But in the livestock world, we definitely know that there is a decline.
There's a virtual epidemic of reproductive disorders in the livestock in the U.S. Some veterinarians and scientists started examining the aborted fetal tissue of livestock that had miscarriages. And they found an organism that was new to science. It was tiny, the size of a virus, but it had some properties of a fungus. They had never seen it before.
We're still not quite sure what it is. We have the DNA now that's in the process of being analyzed, sequenced, so that we can put a name on it. So it's a very small entity. We know that it's fairly heat tolerant, but that it can cause reproductive failure.
In fact, they've taken the organism and exposed it to a pregnant chicken in a laboratory, and it killed the embryo within 48 hours.
Veterinarians have performed Koch's postulates, where they've isolated it from the animal or from fetal tissue. They can culture it in pure culture, reintroduce it to the animal, reproduce all of the symptoms, and then re-isolate it. That establishes a scientific basis that this is the organism or the entity causing the reproductive failure.
This new organism is in high concentrations of soy and corn products that have been sprayed with Roundup. In particular, it's in high concentrations on diseased plants where the diseases are known to be created by Roundup.
Had a producer northwest of the Twin Cities last year that called me and was losing calves to miscarriages, and some cows were dying. He was feeding his cows Roundup Ready corn silage sprayed with Roundup, so it's all GMO, and over the years he's drained the health of his cows down, and it's costing him calves now. And they have had the feed tested and the cows tested, and we're finding the deficiencies that are consistent with Dr. Huber's work. We had liver samples that were sent to a university and found they were all short on manganese, and we had feed samples sent out to a third party to get us into the testing lab for that organism, and it was loaded with the organism.
Secretary Vilsack, as governor of Iowa years earlier, was awarded Biotech Governor of the Year. He's now in charge of agriculture in the United States. Dr. Don Huber sent a letter to Secretary Vilsack describing this organism and describing it as an emergency.
I felt that it would be irresponsible for me as a scientist not to alert the Secretary of Agriculture to the serious nature of the situation as it was developing.
Dr. Huber wrote, "For the past 40 years, I have been a scientist in the professional and military agencies that evaluate and prepare for natural and man-made biological threats, including germ warfare and disease outbreaks. Based on this experience, I believe the threat we are facing from this pathogen is unique and of a high-risk status. In layman's terms, it should be treated as an emergency."
He asked the secretary to hold off on the approval of Roundup Ready alfalfa, because that would increase the use of Roundup in the United States, and if Roundup were linked to this organism, it would pour fuel onto this fire. A few weeks after the letter was received, Huber got a call from the USDA, and he gave them the names of some scientists and veterinarians to talk to. 6 months later, they still hadn't been contacted. Unfortunately, the USDA is completely ignoring the problems with Roundup. They just approved Roundup Ready alfalfa in 2011, as well as Roundup Ready Kentucky bluegrass.
Let's review what we have so far. Genetic engineering transfers genes between species. The process itself creates mutations throughout the DNA, which can produce new allergens, toxins, and other nasties. The inserted genes and their proteins may trigger inflammation, which might promote numerous problems such as digestive disorders, allergies, diabetes, autoimmune disease, cancer, Alzheimer's, kidney disease, thyroid disease, and heart attacks. Genetically engineered BT corn produces an insecticide, which may break holes in our intestinal walls. If so, experts link gut permeability to allergies, autism, and premature aging, as well as other disorders such as autoimmune disease, cancer, asthma, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and others. Most GM plants are engineered to survive doses of Roundup herbicide. Roundup steals nutrients, which can lead to nutrient-deficient plants, animals, and humans. Roundup can also cause birth defects and other reproductive disorders. Lab animals that ate Roundup-ready crops lost a large number of offspring. Roundup is also linked to infertility, which may be from disrupted hormones, nutrient deficiency, or a brand new organism. FDA scientists had warned that GMOs were dangerous, but their boss was a Monsanto man. Monsanto sells Roundup and most GM seeds. The FDA doesn't require any studies and doesn't monitor any health issues linked to GMOs.
I've been writing a syndicated newspaper column called Animal Doctor for about 40 years. And it was in the late 1990s that I started receiving letters from several of my 25 to 30 million readers across the United States indicating that their dogs and cats were having various health problems that were not being treated by their veterinarians effectively. These problems were persisting. And when I advised them to switch the animal's diet to get rid of genetically engineered corn and soybean, and the animal started getting better, I have what I call evidence-based medicine that their health problems were most likely primarily being caused by genetically engineered corn and soybean, and possibly the Roundup herbicide glyphosate residue. And I have at least 40 to 60 letters on file testifying to these magical cures, which the veterinarians were missing. Many of these animals would be put on a special manufactured prescription diet for inflammatory bowel disease or skin allergies, you know, the poor dog just tearing itself to bits, or having diarrhea all over the place and everybody going nuts in the home. But still, they were not being cured, because in a lot of these prescription diets were the same ingredients. The corn and the soy had been genetically engineered.
An agricultural consultant describes an experience he had with a client who was raising miniature steers on a hobby farm.
He was trying to be as organic as possible, and so he was feeding them a non-GMO corn. And he had run out of his corn, so he went to his supplier, and they didn't have anything but GMO corn. And so he started feeding his cattle GMO corn, and he said suddenly he noticed that his steers were having a lot of illness problem. They were getting really agitated, irritated. They just weren't the normal, calm, docile creatures he was used to. He said he lost about 90% of his miniature steers. What the problem was is, I guess he said that they weren't able to process the food correctly and they would bloat up and die from it.
I've got my first major livestock producer that feeds about 5,000 head of cattle. He just made a transition here within the last year in my community.
A lot of trouble with cattle dying the longer you fed them genetically modified crop. The longer we'd feed them, the more deaths we would have. We wouldn't lose cattle the first 60 to 80 days on feed, and from then on we would start losing them one or two a week. And when we switched, the cattle have been a lot calmer, and we've had a lot less pneumonia and health issues since that time.
A farmer got a call from an excited friend who had recently switched to non-GMO corn for his large pig nursery.
I was surprised that he was so worked up. He was just stammering something terrible, trying to explain to me what he wanted to talk about.
The farmer said the pig's disease and medicine costs came way down. Feed intake went up, and the pigs were happier and more playful.
Actually, he says, we've seen things change on about the third day. But he says, my brothers and I walked into barns, and we were all admiring how things were a little different. And he says, we laughed. Well, it's probably that non-GMO corn. He says, we kind of chuckled about it. And he says, we kind of just wrote it off. But he says, we realize now that after 2 to 3 days, we started seeing that change. And he says, by the time I called you, which was day 11, he says, it was dramatic.
The family had been struggling with high disease rates for more than 12 years, ever since they introduced genetically modified corn. But it was only after they witnessed the recent improvement in their pigs' health and behavior that they realized the GM corn was the source of the problem. A pig farmer in Denmark switched to non-GMO soy in April 2011. Within 2 days, the piglet's serious and sometimes fatal diarrhea virtually disappeared. After switching, disease rates plummeted. Death from ulcers and stomach-related sicknesses disappeared, as did a string of horrible birth defects. Conception rates and litter size also increased.
Ozilac is the single most tested new product in history and is now available to you specifically so you can increase your profit potential.
Monsanto scientists took cow genes and put them into E. coli bacteria so that the bacteria produces a hormone for the cow. It's injected into cows to increase milk supply. Nicknamed crack for cows, it revs up their metabolism. Now it also produces more mastitis, a painful udder infection. So there's more pus in the milk, and more antibiotics in the milk, and more bovine growth hormone in the milk. But what's really concerning to doctors is the increase of IGF-1, insulin-like growth factor 1. People with high levels of IGF-1 are more inclined to get cancer. Premenopausal women with high levels of IGF-1 in their blood are 7 times more likely to develop breast cancer. Men are 4 times more likely to develop prostate cancer, and it's in much higher levels in the milk from cows treated with bovine growth hormone.
Beginning in 1994, data from the Federal Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta showed a dramatic increase in the annual incidence of milk duct tissue cancer in American women over 50 years old. The milk duct tissue cancers are among the most vigorous growing and most deadly. This increase over the ensuing 5 years resulted in a 55% to 60% increase in this type of breast cancer.
The approval process of RBGH by the FDA was highly controversial. When Canadian scientists from Health Canada reviewed how the FDA approved RBGH, they said the whole thing was a facade.
The data that we had on BGH showed enough, there was enough evidence to reject it outright. The US FDA said they didn't get the same data. Then they said they did get it, but only summary. Then they said no, they got it, the whole thing. But then they said Canadians didn't know how to apply the law. That tells you what FDA does.
Now, RBGH is banned in Europe, in Japan, in Australia, and New Zealand. And now it's banned in Walmart's milk, in Starbucks, in Yoplait, in Danone, in most American dairies. Because we've been educating consumers about the risks, especially the cancer risk. And so we've created a tipping point of consumer rejection, which is slowly kicking RBGH out of the market now.
In the end, for all these companies, it comes down to money. If they think they're going to make more money by going RBGH free, they'll go RBGH free. If they think they can get away with making more money by not, they won't. So our job is to make sure that enough people in the public find out about this, tell them about it, and say, you know, if you're going to keep using this, I don't want to buy your product. I'll just go someplace else that doesn't use it. That they understand.
I talked to a former Monsanto scientist And it turns out that three of his colleagues were doing safety studies on the milk from cows treated with bovine growth hormone. But these three scientists found so much IGF-1 in the milk, they refused to drink milk thereafter unless it was organic. One bought his own cow.
Children are particularly more sensitive to GMOs for several reasons than adults. Number one is they have higher metabolic rates. They metabolize food quicker. They need more food. And their cells are changing quicker. They are growing rapidly. So they have a higher cell turnover. They have higher metabolic rates, higher respiratory rates. So they require more nutrition. They eat more. And number two is that children are more sensitive to smaller doses of toxins than adults. We don't respond to toxins the same way.
Their immune system is not prepared for it. They're not able to digest properly. They don't have the enzymes available to them. They don't have their gut bacteria completely developed yet.
The question of this bioaccumulation of toxins might be higher in their bodies. They have a smaller body mass. So for all those reasons, children are more susceptible.
I tell all of my pregnant women how to serve their children non-GMO foods.
We have them eat non-GMO food for at least 2 weeks. At least 2 weeks before trying to conceive, preferably longer, because we know that if mom doesn't, that any gene changes that can be passed on to the baby can be passed on to future generations, and it's a new field of genetics called epigenetics, and that's what I'm worried about. That I thought in the old genetic days we thought that genes weren't so mutable, and we now know that's not true. That they can change expression and quickly. And it's passed on.
If the mother eats the genetically engineered foods, it is going to affect the development and the growth of her child. It's one more factor to throw into the uterine fluid that is not good, and it will cause disaster in time.
There is no pediatrician that is not going to say, nursing, breastfeeding over formula. Let's be clear. So we're all breastfeeding. I've never met a pediatrician who said don't breastfeed in my career. So breastfeeding, and then again breastfeeding. Now, in certain moms, they can't. So those babies will go on formula. I say organic formula only.
I think that pretty much most all soy infant formulas are made from genetically modified soy. So, which means that's a serious health hazard. The risk of allergic reactions is much too great to be feeding that to infants, especially at an early age.
Nearly all infant formulas use milk from cows injected with bovine growth hormone and derivatives of GM corn. And independent laboratory tests found significant amounts of genetically engineered soy in four popular soy-based infant formulas. Similac soy, 42%. Gerber Good Start Soy, 48%. Enfamil Pro Soybe, 49%. Walmart Soy, 66%. The U.S. government's WIC program provides free formula to over 2 million newborns, but only the genetically engineered varieties.
When I first discovered that GMO was in infant formula and infant food, I was outraged, honestly. I didn't know how that could have happened in this country, and I felt guilty as a mother for not knowing that it was in there and I was feeding something harmful to my child. But once I learned it was in there, it was cold turkey, just everything got thrown out and we started from scratch.
They're really vulnerable, and we're giving their parents, before they're born, feeding them GMOs. And we know that things can get into the fetus, like BT toxin and Roundup. And then we're feeding them infant formula with genetically engineered corn and soy and the milk from cows injected with bovine growth hormone. What are we doing to our children?
We're just being told it's probably the best technology out there to feed the world, and that's not even true. So I'm not even sure why we have to have GMO. It doesn't make any sense.
Genetically engineered organisms are really a product to sell people.
And unless there's a company trying to push a product like that and gain money, you know, there's no point in it, because all of us can get along just fine without genetically engineered organisms. There's always a better way to achieve the same end that any genetically engineered organism is trying to do for you. There's a better way when we understand how nature does it. It's less expensive, it doesn't take so much work, and you're not destroying the environment at the same time.
I would say that we've had a huge lie perpetuated upon us by the multinational corporations, making us believe that the GMO is the way to feed the future. It is not. It is a bad idea, because we don't know the adverse effects on health. It is not worth a slight increase in crop production or longevity on the shelf in order to sacrifice that for human health.
We really are at a period in human history where, just because science can do something, doesn't mean that science should do something.
We planted GMOs to Roundup Ready cotton in 2005, 2006, about 1,000 acres. Thought it was going to be an excellent way to remedy our high fuel costs, labor. That was before I started reading the bag on the cotton seed. There's all 7, 8 different warning labels. Don't touch it. Don't put it in your mouth. Don't do this. Run to the doctor. Call this number. And I'm sitting there thinking, what am I planting? What am I actually putting in the earth? I'm trying to save a little bit of fuel. I was adding to the problem. I was adding to this toxic recipe that is creating the need for more chemicals. I mean, that's the solution that we're throwing at all of our problems in agriculture, and we wonder why we have more problems.
The system has done a very, very good job of educating people into the need for GMO grains, because we can't feed the world. It's just the opposite. I just finished the season in my community where we're running trials and putting in test plots for corn. We're doing better than the GMOs, hands down.
The mythology that somehow the people of the world are starving because there's not enough food is very strong and has been drummed into us for 30 years now, 40 years. In fact, there's over 1.5 times more food on the planet than we need for every man, woman, and child. Even Josette Sheehan of the World Food Program admitted at the height of the food crisis that the problem wasn't lack of food. There's plenty of food. People couldn't afford it.
I was at a conference of some of the experts who actually know how to feed the world. And we had Secretary Vilsack there speak to us. And when he started talking about how GMOs could feed the world, he was actually booed and hissed by these experts.
The evidence does not exist to support the claim that GMOs are going to be the way forward to feed the world in a way that's sustainable and equitable in the future.
The world can feed itself. The world has always fed itself. The world has enough food. That due to corruption, people may not be getting food, but there's plenty of food. Monsanto's whole drive to create GMOs is a disaster in front of us now. The world can get rid of it. The world should get rid of it. The sooner the better, now.
There's a lot of GMO myths about what GMOs are supposed to do or can do. They're supposed to increase yields. Well, in actuality, they reduce average yield. Look at the Union of Concerned Scientists report, Failure to Yield. There have been studies done on millions of farms in developing nations showing an average increase of yield of 79% for sustainable techniques, not for GMOs. In the United States, GMOs grown side by side with organic show no difference for soy and corn, except in times of drought where the organic outperforms the GMOs. They also say that GMOs are supposed to increase farmer profit. Well, that's not true.
Essentially, all of the independent studies, and by that I mean a study not paid for directly or indirectly by the biotech industry, all independent studies conclude that GM technology has been close to an economic wash.
They said GMOs would increase U.S. exports. The opposite happened. We lost 99% of our corn exports to Europe.
The biotech industry has claimed for years that herbicide-tolerant crops reduce the pounds of herbicides applied. And while that's true for the first few years after a new herbicide tolerant crop variety is introduced, after a few years there's shifts in weeds and the beginning of resistance emerges, and we see a steady incremental rise in herbicide use.
A study found that 323 million more pounds of pesticides have been applied on genetically engineered crops compared to their non-engineered counterparts in the U.S. We've got 10,000 acres of cotton in Georgia that are now resistant to all herbicides, including glyphosate. So guess how they're controlling them? They're having to use machetes. Glyphosate's no longer working, so now they want to get crops that are engineered with 2,4-D. For those of you that are too young to know that, that was one of the components of Agent Orange, so that's not a benign herbicide.
There is so much increase in the use of Roundup. It's now found by the U.S. Geological Survey in 60 to 100% of the air samples, the rain samples, and the water samples. It's in the urine of city dwellers. It's in the blood of pregnant women. It's in their fetuses. It's everywhere.
It's a scam. This is a money-making scam for these billion-dollar corporations. It's not going to improve our quality of life. It's not going to improve anything that happens within nature.
It's not about feeding the world. It's not about the blind will see and the lame shall walk. It's about chemical companies selling chemicals.
When I heard the Monsanto master plan, I was stunned. The goal of Monsanto was to replace all natural seed, to have all global agriculture completely driven by genetically modified seed, and to create a market for the chemicals associated with those genetically modified seed. There was no sense of nature. There was discussion of how to eliminate natural seed.
When I get in discussions with people, they say, well, the government reviewed them, the governments approved them, there were mountains of studies done. They couldn't have gotten it that wrong, and if it was so bad, somebody would speak up about it. But in reality, the few people that have spoken up about it have paid a high personal and professional price for it. The attacks on people who have raised questions about this technology are very well covered. They're no secret, and they've had a very chilling effect on the willingness of other scientists to even want to carry out the work. One way to discourage scientists from working in an area is to show them that if they happen to come up with findings that don't jive with the PR message from the biotech industry, and if they were to go on and publish their results or talk about them at a professional meeting, that their dean is going to be visited by a contingent from the companies. Politicians at the state level will be visited and said, gee, you know what's going on in the agronomy department at the university? There's this professor, he's out to hurt your farmers. You better call the dean up and get that person back on message. And this happens absolutely routinely.
And quite frankly, because of the direct investments of these companies in our universities, new professors know very well that if you expect to get tenure, don't do any negative research on GMOs.
When I spoke to the United Nations about the dangers of genetically engineered organisms, and then I returned to my department at Oregon State University, I soon afterwards received a letter from a past president of Oregon State University, basically saying that if you didn't believe in the technology, if you weren't heart and soul into this industry, this technology, that you really didn't belong at Oregon State University.
It's just remarkable the degree to which a single company has been able to dominate what gets discussed, how it's discussed, and who is willing to participate in that debate.
Researchers have a hard time getting a hold of seeds in order to carry out research because Monsanto, Syngenta, and DuPont will not give the seeds away for research. They keep the seeds, they do their own research, which supports their own industrial objectives. So it's very difficult to do research, and then once it's done, it's very hard to get out there.
Many researchers that are involved in working on GMO crops are severely penalized. They've lost their jobs, they've had their funding canceled, been moved out of their laboratories.
As soon as you go up against these multinational corporations, they try to shred your reputation. They try to suggest that your methodology is inappropriate, is not right.
Ultimately, the buck stops at the scientist evaluating. That's me. Then if I agree, then I'm part of the corruption. That's happening. If I don't agree, I get fired. I chose to be fired.
Dr. Arpad Pusztai, one of the leading researchers in the world in his field, was given a grant of $3 million to figure out how to test for the safety of GMOs. His research was supposed to create the protocols that would be used for approvals in the EU. He put rats through his protocols, and it turns out the process of genetic engineering was inherently unsafe and caused potentially precancerous cell growth in their digestive tracts, smaller brains, livers, and testicles, partial atrophy of the liver, damaged immune system in just 10 days. When he went public with his concerns, he was a hero for about 2 days at his prestigious institute. Then 2 phone calls were allegedly placed from the UK Prime Minister's office, forwarded through the receptionist to the director. The next morning, Dr. Pusztai was fired from his job after 35 years, silenced with threats of a lawsuit. His 20-member research team was disbanded. They took away the data. They never implemented his protocols. Instead, they embarked on a campaign to destroy his reputation. In Argentina, when the scientist Andrés Carrasco was planning to give a lecture to a group about Roundup and its link to birth defects, an organized mob of about 100 attacked him. He was able to make it into his car, where he locked himself in, but they beat his car for 2 hours. His friends were not so lucky. One was knocked unconscious, the other paralyzed. Monsanto talks about feeding the world. This is their PR concoction. Let's take a look at what's happening in India. They took over the cottonseed industry and are forcing millions of farmers to plant their BT cotton. Now, cotton is engineered to produce an insecticide which breaks open the stomach of insects and kills them. The normal natural BT is found in soil bacteria. When that's used as a spray, in the Pacific Northwest, for example, for gypsy moths, about 500 people complained of allergic and flu-like symptoms. Some had to go to the hospital. Now in India, thousands of workers are complaining of the same symptoms. Many are getting rashes, and many are itching.
Farmers have been complaining that they have itching. When they grow, they go to pluck, they have an itching sensation.
In India, they allow animals to graze on the cotton plants after harvest. They've had no problem for years. When they introduced BT cotton, however, they noticed that thousands of animals got sick and thousands died. There's a small organization called Deccan Development Society that pleaded with the government to do tests on the BT cotton to see if it was causing the animal deaths. They went to the government, they didn't follow through. They went to universities, they didn't do anything. So DDS did the study itself. They took 9 sheep. 6 were eating either Bolgard 1 or Bolgard 2 BT cotton, 3 non-GMO cotton plants.
So within a month, all the animals which ate on Bolgard 1, Bolgard 2, they died. And the animals which ate on non-BT, non-PSL managed cotton are still alive and are still active.
I visited a village in Andhra Pradesh. They had allowed their buffalo to graze on cotton plants after harvest for years without a problem. They allowed their 13 buffalo to graze on BT cotton plants for a single day. Within 3 days, all 13 buffalo were dead. We know that the crops that are genetically engineered have unpredicted side effects. This can not only affect health, but also the agronomic properties. The BT cotton grown in India is extremely unreliable. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But there they have no safety net. Millions of farmers have invested money in the more expensive seeds and associated chemicals. Many have borrowed heavily at high interests. When the cotton doesn't work out, many of these farmers cannot even pay back their high interest loans. The number of farmer suicides as a result is astounding.
High cost seed with unreliable performance is what is getting farmers into debt, and debt is what is causing the farm suicides. All our studies over the last decade show that the suicides are concentrated in the cotton areas, and in cotton, much higher suicides in the BT cotton belts. My assessment is 250,000 farm suicides in this country, of which at least 3/4 is BT linked.
A farmer in South Africa was growing genetically engineered corn and feeding it to his animals. His dairy cows were having problems with milk production, arthritic-type conditions, infertility, and short lifespans. The pigs were also affected.
The biggest single thing was reproductive failure. They'd have respiratory issues, things like pneumonia, for instance, and then they'd also get scours or diarrhea to the point, anyway, that they would succumb to death. They would be cannibalistic. They would literally eat the tails right off each other. You know, Dr. Scow, he said, you've told me so many things, we've discussed so many things. Can you narrow it down to just one simple thing I can go home and do? And I says, yeah, very easily to do. I says, go home and never, ever put another GMO product on your farm.
After growing non-GMO corn and feeding it to his animals, within a few weeks, the health problems disappeared.
So he went along for about 5-6 months until he ran out of his feed supply. And guess what? The only feed available was, again, GMO-based feeds. The dairy herd within 60 days was right back in the same mess it was before. The swine herd took about 3 months, and they were right back in the same predicament that they were before.
In South Africa, corn is the staple, eaten 3 times a day. The 50 to 60 workers on this farm were eating only the GM corn grown there. They were likely eating more genetically engineered food each day than any group in the world.
The health issues that they was running into was things like upper respiratory, colds, runny noses, just an achy feeling similar to like having the flu, and headaches, severe headaches. About once or twice a month, he'd have one of his laborers come to him, and these were not older people. These were younger people in their mid-20s through mid-40s. And he'd notice one very dramatic thing. He'd see the individual, and they'd be talking and looking at each other in the eye, and one eye would go this way, and at the same time, the other eye would go this way, so they didn't track, like turning one way or the other. Now, when he noticed that, or that occurred, normally that person would be dead within 24 to 48 hours after seeing that particular symptom.
When the farmer harvested non-GMO corn for his animals, the workers also switched to non-GMO corn.
His labor force had cleared up completely of the health issues they were having, why they were on the non-GMO.
And then he ran out.
It took about 30 to 40 days, and they were right back in the same predicament as before. Since then, I've heard from him a time or two, and he says now he has all non-GMO, and thanked me for the advice of never planting another GMO.
People always ask me, can we reverse the damage from eating a genetically modified diet? Well, mice in an Italian study give us some hope. They were fed genetically modified soy for 8 months and showed damage to their livers, pancreas, and testicles. But when they were put on a non-GM soy diet for the next month, a lot of the problems reversed.
when we teach doctors in this country and other countries about the importance of diet, one of the key factors that we teach is avoid all GMO foods.
One thing that's consistent in every single patient is removal of GMOs.
I've had a lot of different patients come in with various stages of chronic disease. That's what I specialize in, sort of these complex cases. And by changing the diet around, changing their nutritional status, a lot of the things that they come in with literally just go away.
Of course, GMO isn't the only thing that I do. I would never just do that. I use whatever works for patients individually. We look at what they're eating, and we take out the genetically modified foods and the industry foods, and they all get better. So it pretty much takes from 2 days to 2 to 3 months, and some people continue to recover over a couple of years, but it never doesn't work.
We have to somehow or other educate the public so that they understand that they have a choice. They don't have to eat genetically engineered foods.
There are only 9 genetically modified food crops, but their derivatives are found in over 70% of the foods in the supermarket, particularly the processed foods. There are 4 ways to avoid GMOs: by organic, by products that say non-GMO, by products listed in our non-GMO shopping guide, or avoid the at-risk ingredients altogether. Principally, soy, corn, cottonseed oil, canola oil, and sugar from sugar beets. Most of those crops are genetically engineered. So if it's grown in the US and it doesn't say organic or non-GMO, it's genetically engineered.
If we can avoid those, I think certainly that would be a big step in improving people's health in terms of allergies, autoimmune disease, and a lot of conditions that we don't really even know too much about.
Also, aspartame is derived from a genetically engineered microorganism. Just Google aspartame and symptoms and camp out for a few hours. You'll never eat aspartame again. When people hear about the health dangers of GMOs, the first thing they want to do is avoid them. Millions of people are trying to avoid GMOs, and we make it easier for you. Go to non-GMOshoppingguide.com and find thousands of products that have been verified as non-GMO. Or download the free iPhone application, Shop No GMO. Or get our booklet. It makes it much easier for you to shop for healthier non-GMO products.
And we're very thankful for the organizations that are now certifying products that are non-GMO so that we can have that assurance that we're buying something that we support.
And when you look for non-GMO labels, look for Non-GMO Project Verified. They're a third-party verifier, and they back up the claims that companies make.
The Non-GMO Project is a nonprofit organization that's committed to preserving a non-GMO food supply, educating consumers about the GMO issue, and providing verified non-GMO choices. In the last year, sales of Non-GMO Project Verified products have gone from $348 million to over $1.2 billion. So the growth is incredible. It's 219% growth, and that's because so many more brands are enrolling because so many more consumers are asking for it. We have close to 400 brands that have enrolled in the Non-GMO Project, 6,000 products at this point, 4,000 of them are verified. And the commitment of these companies is coming from consumer demand. People are asking for non-GMO choices. They don't want to be part of the GMO experiment. They don't want to feed GMOs to their families. And companies in the organic and natural products industry are really stepping up by getting their products verified and getting them labeled so that people can opt out of the GMO experiment.
Currently, there are no legal requirements in the U.S. to label a product containing GMOs.
The failure to disclose in this, to me, is the real issue. Europe labels these things, Australia labels these things, Asia labels these things, and yet here in the U.S. we've all just been blissfully ignorant. I have a problem with that because it's not in the best interest of my family.
It's hard enough as a mom to have to go in and read every label. Your time's limited, and you really have to be knowledgeable about it. It should have been in there all along. I feel like we were tricked.
We're all part of a large, uncontrolled experiment, and we aren't getting answers because we don't know who's eating genetically engineered food and who isn't. So we have no way to do the studies. I suspect that this is the intention of the manufacturer. Let's sow confused the situation that no liability could ever be ascertained, even if there is a big problem.
Right now, there are about 5 million kids with food allergies, and there's no way of knowing what is in the food that you're feeding your child unless it's labeled.
These products are on the shelf before you even know they are, and now they're in everything.
I don't want to be a human lab rat, and I certainly don't want my two-year-old daughter to be a human lab rat.
So if there is no problem with GMO food, then why don't we just label it? If it's not a problem, I say label it. And so that is coming down the pike. It's a 2012 ballot initiative campaign to label GMOs, and I say support it.
The GMO labeling issue is on fire in the United States. Bills have been introduced in 19 states, although none have yet gotten past Monsanto's lobbying and influence peddling. In California, we have a real chance of victory because in California, it's a ballot initiative. People vote directly. So we finally have a chance to get what 9 out of 10 Americans have wanted for more than a decade, mandatory labeling of genetically engineered foods.
I have enough questions about this technology to wonder what's happening with us. We have studies that say everything's okay, that in the industry, an industry that I don't trust. We have studies by independent doctors that say there are huge questions and that there are problems. There have been no long-term human studies done on this, and I, as a grandmother and a mother, am outraged that our government and that our agencies are not taking care of this for us. They're not protecting us. We have a right to know what we're putting inside of our bodies.
The entire world is looking to California because we can turn it around from this one place. The enormity of the threat is unprecedented in history. All living beings, all future generations. So the enormity of the solution is something that we cannot afford to let slip away.
You know, if you like GMOs, you think they're great, okay, label it, you know, just be proud of it, buy it, label it, and, you know, but we have a right not to buy it. So, you know, that's our issue, and you know, we're taking that to Washington. You know, we gotta bring outside pressure, we gotta bring a wake-up call to FDA, and yeah, make our voices heard.
We're taking back the power to the people. We have people all over this state that are working nonstop in communities, 151 leaders that are organizing their communities, that are getting out there, they're educating their people. We understand what's going on now with government and with corporations.
Folks, this is what can happen when one very persistent, semi-obnoxious Italian grandmother from California decides that it will. All it takes.
I just want these corrupt governments and corporations to leave my body alone, to leave my family alone, to leave my milk alone, my food alone, my family alone, my community alone. I can take care of myself. The whole world can take care of itself.
You want to know the dirty little secret of the biotech industry that they never talk about? No one gets up in the morning wanting to buy a GMO food. No one, not a single human being on earth gets up and says, boy, I can't wait to go to the supermarket and buy a GMO food. And why is that? That's because after 30 years and hundreds of billions of dollars of public and private investment, they haven't been able to come up with one thing in this food that actually helps the consumer. No better taste, no lower price, no more nutrition, nothing, zip, zero, nada.
How do we get rid of genetically engineered foods? It's much easier than you think. And we don't have to ask the government for a bailout. We can do it ourselves. In Europe, when they achieved the tipping point of consumer rejection at the end of April 1999, within about a week, most major food companies committed to stop using GM ingredients. They had become a marketing liability. In the United States, as parents became aware of the cancer link to bovine growth hormone, it was kicked out of most American dairies. How many Americans will it take avoiding GMOs to create a tipping point in the United States? We think only 5%. Why? If the same food companies that already kick GMOs out in Europe see even a small drop in market share in the United States that they can directly attribute to anti-GMO sentiment on the rise here, they will get rid of it here like they already got rid of it in Europe. It becomes a food industry sell signal, getting rid of GMOs, and we can do it ourselves.
These companies are parasites. They don't care. They want to make money, they want to run governments, and they are right now running governments. I don't know how long, but I think their time is running out.
While you can't control what was produced yesterday, by what you spend today, you get to control what is produced tomorrow.
Moms and consumers are the ones that are going to make this change. They're going to be the ones who are going to drive the change. If we demand that products be safe and healthy for our children, if we refuse to purchase products that we know are genetically modified, then the industry is going to have to respond, because at some point, you know, mothers are the ones that are out there buying 80% of the consumer products, including the food supplies and the cleaning supplies and whatnot. And if we stop supporting those companies that are doing this, then they're going to feel it in their pocketbook. And unfortunately, I think that's where it really matters to them.
A mother protecting her child is one of the most fundamental forces in nature. And most women would do anything to protect their child. And so to harness that power in a positive way is something that no one could mess with.
This impacts everything and everyone. It's not just an agriculture issue, it's not just a food industry issue, it's an ever-living creature issue.
It's the most dangerous thing facing human beings in our generation.
Should you be concerned? I should think you'd be scared silly, not only for your children, but for you. Why do you think so many people are sick now? We cannot tolerate what's going on any longer. We must stand up and be counted. We must write our politicians. We must talk to the people at the store and say, I'm not going to buy it unless it says not genetically engineered.
I think we now can change the system. The world is ready.
You know, sometimes we hear that Monsanto can't be beat, you know, that the genie's out of the bottle or the genes are out of the bottle. But that just is not true. In the last 15 years, you and me and all of us, we have defeated genetically engineered tomatoes. They don't exist. Genetically engineered potatoes, they tried that. We got rid of that. Genetically engineered wheat. That was Monsanto's big, big, big try. All the wheat in the world to be genetically engineered, we defeated that. Genetically engineered rice, we defeated that. Genetically engineered biopharmaceuticals. This is when they were gonna put all those vaccines into your food. That was defeated. Genetically engineered alfalfa, which is going to destroy our organic dairy industry. For 6 years, we have stopped that, and we're right in court to stop it again right now. Genetically engineered bent grass in all your schools and golf courses, we've defeated that. So they can be beat, they have been beat, and we will win. We will win this.
It's in our hands. It's right in front of us. It's just a matter of avoiding genetically modified foods and inspiring others to do the same.
And my new school, I'm going to try to get the GMOs away from there, too.
What are you going to do?
Just keep on telling them, and then they'll probably get it away.
What are you going to tell them?
Stop doing the GMOs and start doing the good food.
If you give animals a choice, I know for sure they'll take the non-GMO every time.
We have a dog, a mascot dog in the office, cute little Cocker Spaniel. Her name's Chloe, and we decided, well, let's see if she can tell the difference between GMO and non-GMO. She immediately went to a pile of non-GMO corn versus the same right there next to her, GMO corn, and she just tasted it, spit it out, went to the GMO, the non-GMO corn, and ate it. And Chloe does this every time. It's absolutely amazing.
I have feed that I store in my garage for my livestock. Our non-GMO feed is stored directly beside a conventional feed. We have seen where the mice, the rats, the raccoons will attack our non-GM feed and leave the GM feed untouched.
I obtained 4 or 5 cobs of genetically modified corn, took them home, threw them into my hens, which I thought they were going to eat them, but they ran over like to eat them, but they didn't touch any of it.
I set up a feeder side by side with the regular feed store feed, and the chickens chose the non-GMO feed. Naturally, they emptied the feeder without touching the other one. So I refilled it and I says, I'm gonna play a trick on my birds. I flipped it, flipped the two feeders from spot to spot, and the birds still chose the non-GMO feed, which was incredible.